So it will not be a big meeting. I'll not do a large, a big class or something like that. This is just a trial. So I'll just give you some questions and just few questions which can come in your AIIMS exam. Okay. So we'll start it like that. So just give me, okay, so so I'm not admitting anymore now, enough. Okay, so no more, more students will be admitted anymore further. So let's start, okay? Right. Okay. So now we are going to have a very small session on flow cytometry. How many of you know about flow cytometry nicely? How many of you know about flow cytometry? You can on your videos, I can see you better. So how many of you know about flow cytometry? Somewhat or nothing? Know something? Yes? Yes or no? Okay. No? Yes or no? No, nothing, ma'am. Perfect. That's an okay answer, right? So I'm going to quickly give you an overview for your exams. Okay, so this is going to be a very small session for your exams. Okay, so let me just show you a slide. Okay. Okay. Okay, right. So since we're going to do some session, small session today, let me tell you what is a flow cytometry. Okay, so let's okay. Now when we're talking about flow cytometry, everybody should know what is a flow cytometer. Flow cytometry is a very simple machine. Okay, so it is basically this is a flow cytometer machine. Okay, so let me just okay. So this is a flow cytometer machine, okay? So every flow cytometer machine has a light source. This light source is actually, you know, LED light, okay? So what happens is the particles are passing through that, okay? So as soon as the light falls on that particle, no, this light gets scattered according to the properties of the particle, okay? So we can have two types of scatter here, okay? So we can have a forward scatter or we can have a side scatter, okay? So forward scatter always depends upon the size of the cell. More the size, more the forward scatter, okay? Where side scatter depends upon the granularity of the cells. More the number of granules, more the side scatter, okay? So we can have two types of scatters, forward and side scatters, okay? So side scatter always corresponds to the granularity and forward scatter always corresponds to the size of the cell, okay? So remember, this light source is always your LED light usually, okay? Now, what happens is, this is just scattering, okay? So scattering itself gives you a lot of information, but you know, it is, the name of the technique is flow cytometer. That means it is going to measure the cells, the flowing cells. It's going to measure the flowing cells, okay? So therefore, we can use fluorochromes also, okay? Fluorochromes means these are some dyes on which when the light falls, they get excited and they can give different colors, okay? So most common dye that we use is called as FITC, okay? So what is FITC? Fluoroisothiocyanate. What is this called? Fluoroisothiocyanate. Have you heard of this antibody somewhere else also? This fluorescent antibody somewhere else also? Yes. Yes. Immunofluorescence, isn't it? So FITC is a green color antibody. Okay. And we use it in immunofluorescence also. So it gives a very beautiful immunofluorescence. Okay. When it is excited. Okay. Now, apart from that, we can use various other dyes. The other dye that we use very commonly is called as PE. PE means phycoerythrin. This is a red color dye. Okay. Red color dye. Okay. So these are two common dyes that we use for flow cytometer. Okay. So now what do we do is, we tag the molecules with this fluorochromes, okay? So let me give you an example, okay? So let me just show you an example here, okay? So, okay. So now let me give you an example, okay? So let's say these are the lymphocytes, okay? So every cell in our body has some antigens which are present on it, okay? Depending upon the maturation stage. So let's say if it is a stem cell, all of you know stem cells express a molecule which is called as CD34, isn't it? Now as it matures into a mature cell, it will start expressing CD45. I hope you know what is the other name of CD45. This is called as leukocyte common antigen. What is this called as? Leukocyte common antigen. So that means more the immaturity of the cell, okay, if it is a stem cell, it will be expressing CD34. Whereas all the mature cells like lymphocytes, okay, they will express CD45, okay. So this property was very beautifully used in flow cytometry. So what do we do is, in a flow cytometry, till now you have studied that normally we get two types of scatter. What are the two types of scatter? Forward scatter and side scatter. I hope you understand. Forward scatter means the size of the cell, okay. So if I am saying that this is a cell, okay, so what do you mean by this cell? This cell means this has a very big amount of forward scatter. More the cell is among this side, that means more the forward scatter. So that means this person, this cell has more number of forward scatter. Okay, so Whereas a cell which is present here has a very less forward scatter. Okay, very less forward scatter. So that means this cell is very big. All of you know immature cells are more big. So can I say, let's say this is a stem cell. Okay, so stem cell is very big cell. Or a blast. Okay, so this will come in the high forward scatter area. Whereas a mature cell like lymphocyte will come in low forward scatter area. You understand? So this line corresponds, imagine it from negative to positive. Okay, negative to positive. So more you go this side, more the positivity. More you go to this side, more the negativity. Okay. Whereas when I go to the side scatter now, more the number of granules, okay, so more the side scatter. So do you know which cells have more amount of side scatter? Which cells have more amount of side scatter? Granulocytes, granulocytes. All the granulocytes have more side scatter, okay? So granulocytes like neutrophils, eosinophils, basophils, they have more side scatter. You understand that? So this is side scatter. Now suppose I am drawing a cell like this. Now you're going to tell me, I'm not going to tell you, okay? So I'm going to draw a cell like this. And I'm saying, this is a forward scatter and this is a side scatter and you are getting a cell here. Okay, so you're getting a cell here. So what does this mean? What does this mean? Can you tell me what does this mean? So if I draw a quadrant like this, what does this mean? Can I say this means that this cell is present on the positive side here? That means this cell has a large amount of forward scatter also. So this is a very large cell. Plus, if I draw from negative to positive here, that means this cell also has large amount of granules. So large cell with granules present in it. So what is this? This is a myeloblast. What is this? This is a myeloblast. This is what is a myeloblast. But look at this if I draw a cell here. Okay, so that is some cells coming here. That means these are the cells which have high forward scatter, but they don't have granules because they are lying in the negative side of the side scatter. So they don't have granules, but they have very big cells. So which cells are they? They are lymphoblast. They are lymphoblast. Can you understand that? So these are lymphoblast. You understand? So suppose I'm drawing some cell here. Okay, that means this does not have granules. Okay, these do not have granules and they're very small also. So what are these cells? Lymphocytes, mature lymphocytes. And if I'm drawing some cells here, that means these cells have more amount of side scatter. Okay, and very a small amount of forward scatter. So they are mature cells, but they have granules. So what are they? Granulocytes. You understand that? So with the help of forward scatter and side scatter itself, we can identify whether the population has mature cells or not. You understand? So if you're seeing a peripheral smear and you suspect a blast is present in that, then, okay, just put forward scatter and side scatter tube. You will be knowing that whether blasts are present or not. But, you know, they said, let us use better technique. Let us use a CD45. Let's use CD45. So I hope everybody knows what is CD45. CD45 is a marker of maturity, mature cell. So see, they said, let us use the marker of maturity. Okay. So what do we do is we tag it with some fluorochrome, like say FITC. So FITC is a fluorochrome, which is going to give you a green color fluorescence. Okay. So now suppose some cells are coming here. Some cells are coming here. Okay. So can you tell me what is this? Can you tell me? So this is a mature cell, which is having CD45 and they don't have any side scatter. So what are they? They are mature lymphocytes. So this is the population where mature lymphocytes come. Okay. But now I say some cells are present here. Okay. So what is this? What do you understand by this? So these cells do not have CD45 or they are dim CD45. That is, they're not completely negative, but they are dim. Dim means lesser than normal, lesser than normal. So they are dim CD45, but they do not have side scatter also. So dim CD45 means they are immature cells. They are immature cells. So this is the population for, this is the area for lymphoblast. And this was your AIIMS question, which came up. This was your AIIMS question, which came last year. Okay, blast window. So blast window is always created on CD45 and side scatter. Okay, CD45 and side scatter. So let me show you an image now, a real image of a flow. Okay. Okay, so let's look at this image now. Okay. So now look at this. So this is a CD45 and side scatter. Can you see this real plot here? So now I am going to draw, imagine in your mind, drawing from negative to positive, from negative to positive. Okay, so you are going to draw from negative to positive. Okay, so now everybody can understand this. Okay, so everybody can understand this, that this population here is a very strongly CD45 positive population and it does not have side scatter. So what is this? These are lymphocytes. Whereas, can you look at these cells here? These cells are dim CD45 and they don't have side scatter. So they are lymphoblast. They are lymphoblast. Okay, so yes, lymphoblast can also be in the negative range, but majority of the time they are dim CD45. They are majority dim CD45. So is everybody clear with this? Okay, so that is how we basically interpret flow cytometer with the help of various markers. Okay, so apart from that, now suppose, what is the rule? Okay, so how should you put up a flow cytometer? So let's see how do we put up a flow cytometer. Okay, so let's look at this now. Okay, so now let us look at this now. Okay, so let us look at this. Now, so whenever we have to put a flow cytometer, just identification of blast is not important. You also have to categorize the blast. So the rule of flow cytometer is that you have to put, number one, immaturity markers. Number one, you have to put marker of immaturity. First, you should identify that stem cells are present in it. So markers of immaturity is either you put up stem cell marker itself, that is CD34. Now, marker of immaturity differs in lymphoblast, okay, and myeloblast. It differs in lymphoblast and myeloblast, okay. So let us say, if it is a lymphoblast, the most immature lymphoblast will have TDT. So TDT is the marker of lymphoblast, okay? Whereas myeloblasts will be usually positive for HLA-DR. The immaturity marker of myeloblast is HLA-DR. So these are commonly used immaturity marker, okay? Apart from these immaturity markers, this is the rule. You also have to put markers of maturity. That is, you have to identify, let us say that the blasts are there, but you have to identify the lineage of the blast. That is, lineage. So which lineage blasts are they? So they can either be B lineage blast, or they can be T lineage blast, they're lymphoblast, or they can be myeloid lineage blast, okay? Or they can be myeloid lineage blast. So pan B cell marker is CD19, pan T cell marker is CD3, and pan myeloid marker is myeloperoxidase, okay? So these are called lineage markers. They are definite markers that which define the lineage, okay? CD19, CD3, and MPO. They are definite lineage marker. So whenever I put a flow cytometer, I prefer to put immaturity marker, that is CD34, TDT, and HLA-DR, and a maturity marker, that is 19-3 and MPO, to classify the type of leukemia. Apart from that, myeloid cells, we also put two other markers which can be used, but they're not definitive marker, but they define myeloid lineage, 13 and 33. So they are also myeloid lineage marker, they're granulocytic marker, but they're not definitive. They're not definitive. So let us look at the real flow cytometer now. Okay, so I'm going to show you a real image again. Okay. Right. So let's see some images, okay? So that will make you more clearer, okay, with everything. Okay. So the first graph on the screen, everybody. Okay, so first utility of flow cytometer is in leukemia that we're going to see, okay? Okay. Okay, so let's look at this, okay? So now I'm going to show you these, okay? So look at the first graph here. So this image, everybody is clear. So this is the image of flow cytometer. Yes, so everybody's clear with this. Now look at the second image, which is shown to you in the screen. Okay, so you are going to identify this now. So what are these? So these are your, this is your population, and you have tagged it with two markers now, CD45 and TDT. So what are the two markers that you put now? CD45 and TDT. Now, all of you know that, so can you see these 64% of the cells? So you remember you have to draw a marker from negative to positive, and from here also negative to positive. So can you see these cells here are negative or CD45? So that means they are immature cells. They are immature cells. So now you want to classify that really are they immature? So let's put TDT. So did you saw that these cells are positive for TDT? These cells are positive for TDT. 64.2% of them are TDT. So TDT was an immature marker of which lineage? Can you tell me which lineage? It was lymphoblastic lineage, isn't it? So this is your ALL, okay? But can you tell me, is this a B cell ALL or a T cell ALL? Can you tell me? No, you cannot. Why can you not tell me? Because you have not put lineage marker. You do not know whether it is a B cell ALL or it is a T cell ALL. So that goes for another question again that was asked in your AIMS last year. So TDT is a marker which is expressed by any lymphoblast, irrespective of the type. It can be B lymphoblast or it can be T lymphoblast. Any lymphoblast will be positive for TDT, okay? So that means this is an incomplete flow diagram. You have not been able to classify the lymphoblast. So what do you need to do now? You need to put a lineage marker. Only when you put a lineage marker, you will be able to identify. Okay, so let's look at this now. So can you identify now? So look at this. So this is a flow diagram. So whenever they give you two or three graphs, you all have to interpret all of them together. Okay, so can you see here? What do you see? So this is a population here, which is in the positive side here. So draw always when you see a flow, make a negative and positive here. Okay, so negative, positive. Okay, negative, positive. So can you see here? This is a population which is positive for CD34. So that means your immaturity markers are present. So now that is very well defined that there is an immaturity marker. Perfect. So immaturity. So this is a blast. Okay. Now look at the another marker. So CD33. So that means it is positive for CD33 also. So CD33, did we remember? Do you remember which lineage? You know it's blast, but which lineage blast are they? Myeloid, isn't it? So this is a myeloid. I remember I told you definitive marker for myeloid lineage is MPO, but it is also positive for 13 and 33. So this is 33 positive. So this is a case of AML. This is a case of AML because there's a myeloid lineage and they are blast. Okay, now let's go to another one. Can you see this? What do you see here? Again, here the markers are coming here. So here means it is on the positive side of TDD. It is also on the positive side of 22. So that means these populations are positive for 22 and TDD. So it is positive for CD22 and TDD. So because it's positive for both, CD22 is a marker of, so all the double digit numbers, remember, okay, 10, 11, 12, all the double digit numbers are usually B lineage. Exception to the rule. Can anybody tell me what is the exception to the rule? CD28. Okay, so CD28 is not a B cell marker. Okay, so remember this. otherwise majority of the double digit numbers are B lineage markers. In that also definite of B cell marker is CD19. Okay, so remember CD22 is positive and TDT is there. TDT means immaturity is there. This is a lymphoblast. Now you don't know whether it is a B lymphoblast or it is a T lymphoblast. So you have to put a lineage marker. So we have put 22. So it shows you B. But what is the definite of lineage marker? It is CD19. So again you put up CD19 here and you saw that this population was positive for CD19. But it was also positive for CD10. So why did you need to put CD10? I hope everybody knows CD10 is a marker of germinal center. Okay, so whenever ALL is positive for CD10, it indicates good prognosis of CLL. Okay, so good prognosis of ALL. It gives you good prognosis. That is why CD10 is also known as CALA. What is CALA? Common ALL antigen. This is also called as common ALL antigen. Okay, so CALA. So that is why it gives you good prognosis. So whenever you have an ALL case, you always put up CD10 also, and it gives you a good prognosis. It gives you a very good prognosis. So is everybody clear with this? So can you say from this flow that it is a B cell ALL with good prognosis? So irrespective of the, so flow cytometry not only tells you whether it is a leukemia or not, it also tells you the prognosis also, okay, by you putting up prognostic markers, okay? So this is B cell ALL. Everybody clear with this, okay? So now let's look at this population here, okay? So now we are clear with acute leukemias. Now one more point about acute leukemia here, which everybody should know, is biphenotypic, okay? So biphenotypic acute leukemia. So let me again show you. Let me take you back to this, okay? Okay, so biphenotypic leukemia means, biphenotype means it shows you both the lineages, okay? So it shows you two lineages. Biphenotypic leukemia means two lineages, okay? So for that, you have to see the definitive marker. Like for myeloid lineage, the definitive marker is MPO. For the lymphoid lineage, if it is a B lymphoid, you have to see CD19 positive. Suppose CD19 is dim. Okay, so CD19, if it is strong, it is good enough. But if CD19 is not strong, it is dim, then you should have any two other B cell markers. Let's say CD10 and CD22. So if CD19 is dim, then other two B cell markers should be there. Okay, for lymphoid lineage, for B lymphoid lineage. For T lymphoid, we have a definitive marker that is CD3. We have definitive marker that is CD3. So to call a biphenotypic leukemia, we should have MPO for myeloid. We should have 19, or if 19 is not there, any two B cell markers. And for T cell, we should have CD3. So let me show you a graph and you're going to interpret it. Okay, so everybody's going to interpret it. Okay, so let me show you a graph. Okay. So I have to choose cases which are for your level, undergraduate level. So majority of these are for postgraduate levels. But okay, let me show you something which is for an undergraduate level. Okay, so this one. Yeah, so I can show you this one. Okay, so let's look at this. Okay. Right. So look at this image, everybody. Can you see this? So this again, so this is a real case. Okay. So can you see this? So what do you see here? You put side scatter versus CD45 plot. And what did you saw? You saw that majority of the population here was negative, dim to negative for CD45. That means this is a blast. Okay. And this is a blast population. And because it is coming in the low side scatter area, so it looks like a lymphoblast. Now you put another lineage marker. Okay. So lineage marker that you put was CD19, CD10. So can you see all of this was positive for CD19? So at this position, now you wanted to put an immaturity marker. You've not put immaturity marker, isn't it? But you just know that it is CD45 dim, so probably it is a blast. Okay, but then I put an immaturity marker here. Okay, so therefore I've started using some marker here. Okay, so I put an immaturity marker here, that is TDT. So as soon as I put TDT, you saw that majority of the cells are positive for TDT. So you're pretty sure now that these are your B lymphocytic leukemia. But okay, CD79 is also a marker of B lineage, so you're pretty clear. But MPO was negative. So this is a red population that you've tagged. So red population was your blast. And it was coming in the negative region. So there was no MPO here. So there's no MPO. Okay, but then you started putting another marker. Let us say this is CD13. Okay, so this is CD13. Okay, so now, okay, so CD13, let's say this blast came out to be positive for CD13, okay, so now is this biphenotypic leukemia? You're getting a TDT positive, you're getting CD13 positive, CD79A positive. Is this a biphenotypic leukemia? No. To make it as a biphenotypic leukemia, your MPO should also be positive. If MPO is also positive, then only it is a biphenotypic leukemia. Otherwise, this is called as ALL with aberrant CD13 positivity. What is this called as? ALL with aberrant CD13. So this is what is called as ALL with aberrant CD13 positivity. So please remember, definitive markers should come positive to call it as a biphenotypic leukemia. Now, one more question. Can you tell me one acute leukemia? So this is a chocolate question. Whoever answers will get a chocolate, okay? So which acute leukemia, okay, does not show immaturity marker? So can you tell me one acute leukemia which does not show immaturity marker? Okay, so let's see who answers. Okay, so whoever answers will get a chocolate, okay? So I'm going to see how many, who answers. Okay. Okay, very good. Okay, so but Raj is a postgraduate. Okay, so Pavan also, Siddharth, everybody answered. Okay, perfect. Right, Kanu also answered. Everybody answered. Okay, so APML is the answer. Okay, so APML is the leukemia which does not show immaturity marker. There's a very typical flow pattern which they give you for APML. Do you know the pattern? What is the pattern? What is the name of that pattern called as in that you get an AML? That's a very, very typical name which you get. Okay, what is that called as? Anybody who will tell me the name of the pattern or flow cytometry that you get in flow cytometry in APML. What is that name of the pattern called? Anybody? Anybody? It is called raindrop pattern. What is this pattern called? Raindrop pattern. So can you see this? So now these are all your cleaved cells. So they are all promyelocytes. They have abundant or rods in them. So they are promyelocytes. All are abnormal promyelocytes. They are not blasts. So because they are not blasts, they will not be positive for immaturity marker. They are promyelocytes. Okay, abnormal promyelocytes. Now can you see, if you put CD45 and side scatter, this is how you will get a population. This is called as a raindrop pattern. Okay, so that type of flow gram when you get, because you're not getting like a blast cluster which you've seen. No, here you will get a cluster like this. This is called as a raindrop pattern. And this will be negative for CD34 and HLA-DR. Okay, so if you put up HLA-DR, you will see that this is negative for CD34. It is negative for HLA-DR. Okay, it's negative for HLA-DR. CD117 is also called as c-kit. It is a marker of granulocytes. Okay, so everybody clear with this? So CD34 negative, HLA-DR negative, acute leukemia is your APML, which everybody should be knowing it. Okay, now once you're clear with this, now this was basically basic utility of the question that they can give you in acute leukemias. What is the other utility of flow cytometer? So please remember, flow cytometer has so many uses, okay, not only in acute leukemia but also in RBCs and also in platelets and also in immunodeficiencies. So these are the other uses of flow cytometer. So let us see some cases and then we will close this session, okay, because my time is going to get over. So let's quickly see. So apart from acute leukemia, chronic leukemias also. So chronic leukemias are not positive for immature markers. So you have to identify the markers, okay? So can you look at this? So CLL and mantle cell lymphoma is one of the commonest images that is given in flow cytometry to you as an undergraduate. Okay, so remember this. So remember, can you see the populations coming here? That means it is on the positive side of CD5 and it is also on the positive side of CD23. So these populations are positive for 5 and 23. So 5, 23 positive leukemia is your CLL. Nowadays, you know, remember this always, that CLL is identified by a better marker, CD200. So CD200 is a better marker for CLL than the other marker. So remember, what is the marker? CD200. That's the marker for CLL, which everybody has to remember. Now, can you see this case, second case here? So it is positive for CD5, but it is not positive for 23. Okay, so not positive for 23. Okay, so what is this? Only CD5 positive leukemia, which is 23 negative. This is mantle cell lymphoma. And nowadays, we put a better marker for mantle cell lymphoma, that is SOX11. Okay, so what marker do you put? Better marker for mantle cell lymphoma? SOX11. Also, remember, mantle cell lymphoma is strongly positive for CD20, whereas CLL is dim positive for CD20. Remember that always. So CD20 is strongly positive in mantle cell lymphoma and it is dim positive in CLL. Okay, so that's another point that everybody should be very crystal clear. So that's your chronic leukemias. Now, apart from chronic leukemias, I told you, this was some student who messaged me this question yesterday. So can you answer this question now? So this is a 58-year-old male. So remember, they will give you a history, but you don't have to give much time to the history when flow is there. Okay, so it will give you a lot of, flow will give you answer itself. So it has lymph node enlargement in an elderly male. He has a leukocytosis of 40,000. Flow cytometer is given. Flow cytometer immediately interpret. Okay, so you saw this. So this population is positive for 5 and 19. Okay, so it is coming in the positive area of 5. So 5 positive. Okay, 19 positive. Now you saw this. This is 23 also positive. Okay, so this is not a good flow that they have put. Okay, so they should have given it together. Normally 5 and 23 is put together. Okay, so it's 23 positive and 5 positive. So 5 positive, 23 positive. Do you need anything else? No, it's CLL. FMC7 is negative. So FMC7 is another marker for mantle cell lymphoma. So 5 and 23 positive acute leukemia has to be CLL. Also remember the clue. CD20 is dim positive. So it's coming, but it is very less. So it is dim positive. So dim positivity for CD20 is also a very good clue to CLL. Okay, so remember that this is CLL. Okay. Now look at this now. So second utility of flow is in the immunodeficiencies that they give you. So this is a 6-month old child who presents with recurrent pneumonia and flow cytometry was done. So now this, I'm going to draw a quadrant for you. Okay. So now what do you see? You see that majority of the cells are here. That means on the negative side. So majority of the cells are negative for CD19 and CD20. And only 0.2% of the cells are CD19 and 20 positive. That means this poor patient has A gamma globinemia. He does not have immunoglobulin, so he does not have B cells in the body. No B cells means no CD19, no CD20. So he's having A gamma globinemia. Okay. Look at the next question. And so this was your AIMS question last year. Please, everybody see this. So this is a 5-year-old presented with recurrent pneumocystis infection. Flow cytometry was done and control was also put. Okay, in B panel and test in D panel and diagnosis. Okay, so this was the image that came in your AIMS last year, and I've been asked so many times about this image. Okay, so B and D. Okay, so now they have put CD19 and CD40. Okay, CD19 and CD40. So they first look at the graph A. In graph A, you saw that CD19 positive B cells are tagged with red color. So red color is given to CD19 positive, side scattered low means B lymphocytes. So they're all mature B lymphocytes. Okay, perfect. Now this was the control. Okay, that is what was given in the history. And these B lymphocytes in red color, because they're 19 positive, they are also positive for CD40. Obviously, you know that normally B lymphocytes are positive for CD40. I hope you remember T cells from your immunity concept. T cells have CD40 ligand and B cells have CD40 on them. And that is why what happens, because of that competent signal, only isotype switching occurs. So that's very, very important. So that means CD40 is positive in normal B cells. But now you look at this. This is the patient. So in the patient, what do you see? So this is a CD19 positive population. Perfect. This is B lymphocyte. But it is negative for CD40. There is no CD40 in them. So these B lymphocytes do not have CD40 on them. So that means, what is the problem here? What is the problem here? What is the problem here? Do you remember that? So CD40 and CD40 ligand, when they will not meet, there will be only one type of antibody that will be produced. Which type of antibody? Only IgM. Other antibodies will not be produced. So this will be a case of hyper-IgM syndrome. This will be a case of hyper-IgM syndrome. Okay. So that is your hyper-IgM syndrome image. Remember, hyper-IgM syndrome could be either due to absence of CD40 ligand on the T cells, or this could be absence of CD40 on the B cells. That is what was given in the image. Okay. So CD40 absent in the B cells, and that is your hyper-IgM syndrome. Everybody clear with this? Okay. Now, look at this again. So I told you flow cytometry is also used in platelet disorders. So platelets are identified by two markers, CD41 and CD61. So these are the two markers for platelets. Again, you saw here that there are very few normal platelets. Majority of the platelets are negative for 41 and 61. So remember, 41, 61, 62, they all represent GP1B, GP28, GP3B. Okay. So that means there is absence of 41 and 61. That means there is an absence of GP2B3A. There is absence of GP2B3A. So can you tell me which platelet disorder is characteristic for absence of GP2B3A? Which is that? Yes. So this is a spot question. Let me see how many of you answer. Which platelet disorder has absence of GP2B3A? Very good, Kanu. This is your Glanzmann thrombosthenia. Okay. So this is your Glanzmann thrombosthenia. Okay. So perfect, Shripriya. So this is Glanzmann thrombosthenia. So this is a case of Glanzmann thrombosthenia, which has absence of 41 and 61 GP2B3A. So this is also picked up on flow cytometry. Okay. So now let's look at the next image. Okay. So once you're clear with this, look at this. So flow cytometry also helps in identifying many cells. So can you say, tell me which are, okay. So let's say, which are these cells? So let's say I'm asking, which are these cells? So can you see these cells are positive for CD16 and CD56 because they're lying in the positive quadrant. So they're positive in CD16 and CD56. So can you tell me which markers are these? These are NK cells. Very good, Smriti and Kanu. These are NK cells. And I hope you remember, NK T cell lymphomas are very, very dangerous lymphomas. Why they're dangerous lymphomas? Because they occur in the nasal cavity and they present with nasal perforation. Okay, so they have nasal perforation. And they, earlier times, they were also called as lethal midline granuloma. So remember that they can be identified by NK cells. So you take cells in these patients and you do flow cytometry and you will be able to identify that they are NK cells. So remember, NK T cell lymphoma is also called as lethal midline granuloma. Very aggressive tumor, presents with septal perforation. Okay, very bad lymphoma. Okay, remember that. Now, can you answer this question again for this? Yes. Which group of cells are shown in flow cytometry here? Okay. So which group of cells are here? So again, look at the markers which we are putting. CD25 and FOXP3. So can you see this? So remember this. So these cells are positive for CD23 and FOXP3. Okay. So CD25 and FOXP3 positive cells are nothing but regulatory T cells. Okay. So these are all regulatory T cells. Okay. So remember the FOX. Okay. So remember the FOX. Okay. So remember the FOX. So I hope you remember this. Do you remember this code, everybody? If you would have studied from me, you would have remembered this code. Okay. G1, L2, P3. Okay. Gravida 1, Life 2, Para 3. Okay. So which tumors, which conditions are these? FOX G1. Have guts to regulate. That's the code. Have guts to regulate. Okay. So Gravida, Life, Para have guts to regulate. Okay. So remember, H is hepatoblastoma. So mutation for hepatoblastoma is FOX G1. Okay, mutation for granulosa cell tumor of ovary is FOX L2 and FOX P3 have guts to regulate. So regulatory T cells. So FOX P3 is a marker of regulatory T cells. You understand that? So that's your hepatoblastoma, granulosa cell tumor and regulatory T cells. Never forget this. Very, very important question. Okay, that can be given to you. Okay, so that is your FOX P3 CD25 positive cells. Okay. So let's look at it. So I told you it is very useful in RBCs also, isn't it? So look at this now. Again, RBCs and platelets and WBCs all are important in flow cytometry. So now this is again a graph here, and you found that this we have put for CD55 and CD59. So what do you see here? Here you say that 74% of the population is positive for 55 and 59. So quite a large amount of population positive. But then 26% of the population is on the negative side, negative for 55 and 59. So whenever it is negative for 55 and 59, that means CD55, 59 negative. What is the answer? What is the answer? So this is very good. PNH, perfect. So how much percent of the cells do you need to call it as a PNH? In negative side, how many cells should be present? 1%. Even 1% cells, if they are present, you should label it as PNH. Okay. Even if 1% cells come in negative clone, it is a PNH. You know why 1%? You know, because PNH is not a static disease. Okay. It's an acquired disease. It's a somatic mutation. Okay. This clone is not going to stop. So even if 1% clone come, it is going to grow up. Okay. And this clone will keep on growing. And finally, the patient will develop aplastic anemia, and he can even develop into acute myeloid leukemia. So therefore, even if 1% cells come in the negative region, that means this is a case of PNH. Okay. So nowadays we are using new markers for PNH, and the most recent marker that we use in PNH nowadays is FLAIR. Okay. So this is fluorescent aerolysin. Okay. So that is the most recent marker which is used in flow cytometry of PNH. That is fluorescent aerolysin. So now, everybody clear with this? Yes. So that is your utilities of flow cytometry in various diseases. We have mostly seen majority of the diseases that can be asked to you as an undergraduate in your AIMS exam. Okay. So I hope everybody will be clear with it. Yes. Okay. So I'll give you one graph, and after that we're going to end this session. Okay. So I'm going to give you one spotter. Let's see how many of you can answer this. Okay. Okay. Yes. So everybody start interpreting. Let's see who answers this. So I'm giving you 5 seconds. Interpret all the graphs together and come to the answer. So red is your target population. I hope you understand that. So this is a real case, okay? Tough for you. It's quite tough, okay? But let's see if you can answer something. Okay, I'll help you. Anybody? Who is it? Ken Elian is saying Hodgkin's. Why Hodgkin's, Elian? Can you tell me why Hodgkin's? Please tell me the reason for Hodgkin's. Why, Narayan? Is there CD15 and CD30 positivity? That is why. So where is CD15? Where is CD30? 15-30 positive. Immature without granules, first one. Pawan is saying. Okay, let me help you. Okay, let me help you. Okay. GIST. Why? CD117. CD117. GIST. So this is flow. We don't put it on solid malignancies usually. No problem. It's good. You're tempting. It's good. So see, I have not allowed anybody after that. There are people waiting in the waiting room. So I've not allowed anybody after that. Only few people I took in the class and just started it. Okay. So I'll help you. See, so these are CD45 dim area, but what do you see? So these cells are positive first, they come in the positive quadrant of CD3. So they're CD3 positive, okay? They're also CD7 positive, okay? So CD3 and CD7 are the markers of T cells, okay? So this is T cells, okay? So some T cells are there, okay? So let us see if there are some immaturity marker that has been put. No, okay? So again, in immaturity markers that they have put is 4 and 8, you know, more the maturity, okay? So whenever the T cells become mature, okay, so they start acquiring CD4 and CD8. So these are negative for 4 and 8, okay? So that means this is early marker only, but negative for 4 and 8, okay? So now, so this is some condition where CD3 is positive, CD7 is positive, okay? CD99 is considered as an immaturity marker in T cells, okay? So this not a very definitive, but yes, we can use CD99. So this is some T cell condition, okay? But it is also positive for very strongly CD33, CD13 and CD33. So these cells are also positive for 13 and 33. So some T cell condition, which is also positive for 13 and 33. This is the most recently described entity in your new WHO. And this is called as ETP-ALL, okay? So early T precursor ALL. So this is the most recent update. Early T precursor ALL is a ALL, which shows you a mixture of, so this is considered as a leukemia, which arises from a very immature clone. And this shows you myeloid markers along with T cells. Okay, so myeloid markers along with T cells. So whenever they give you myeloid markers along with T cells, okay, and they are so whenever you see this, okay, then think of early T precursor ALL, and it has a very proper prognosis. But I have a doubt. Why this is not biphenotypic leukemia? No, I am saying it is a biphenotypic leukemia. Can I say it is a biphenotypic leukemia? No, there are T cells and there is 39, 33, so it's a biphenotypic leukemia. Yes or no? Yes or no? No, why? For biphenotypic, you need which marker? MPO. There is no MPO. So when there is no MPO, how will you call it as a biphenotypic? So MPO is not there. 13 and 33 can be aberrantly expressed. So this is an aberrant expression of 13 and 33 in T cell ALL. It is called as early T precursor ALL, and it has a very, very poor prognosis. Okay, so remember this ETP ALL is the recently added entity in the new WHO. And since all of you are very, very bright students, I must tell you this new entity so that you should never, never, never forget it. Everybody clear with this? Yes? Okay. So now, can you answer majority of the questions on flow cytometry? Yes? Okay. So shall we close the session now? Yes, I hope you understood something. Okay, so was the session useful or not? You should tell me that also. Useful or not? कुछ तो बोलो यार, कुछ तो बोलो, बोलोगे भी नहीं, नहीं बोलोगे, सिर्फ बाय बाय। ओके चलो ठीक है फिर, चलो फिर सेशन बंद करते हैं, अपने बात नहीं करनी है तो। ओके तो शैल वी क्लोज? ओके 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 देन। ओके गाइस, ओके राइट, ओके 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 ओके, थैंक यू गाइस, एंड चलो वी विल कीप मोर सेशंस लाइक दिस नेक्स्ट टाइम, ठीक है? ओके गाइस, बाय बाय, ओके।